I'm Dr. Patrick O'Shaughnessy. Thank you for joining us for today's episode of CHS Presents Health Connect. Catholic Health Services is an integrated healthcare delivery system with some of the region's finest health and human services agencies. CHS includes 6 hospitals, 3 skilled nursing facilities, a regional home nursing service, hospice, and a multi-service community-based agency for persons with special needs. Under the sponsorship of the Diocese of Rockville Center, CHS serves hundreds of thousands of Long Islanders each year, providing care that extends from the beginning of life to helping people live their final years in comfort, grace, and dignity. CHS is focused on quality, and through this show and many community health initiatives, we aim to promote good health and provide you access to the care that you may need. I'd also like to thank and recognize each of CHS's 22,000 employees and affiliated medical staff members for their ongoing commitment to quality and service excellence, which is evident at each and every patient encounter. You all are the face of CHS, and we thank you for all you do for our patients and residents every day. High reliability organizations, or HROs, work to recognize and address any errors before significant harm can occur. Such organizations train their leaders and staff on error prevention techniques that facilitate effective communication, situational awareness, and most important, improve the culture of safety. Enhanced reporting of both harm events and near misses is encouraged so learning can occur and processes can be changed to optimize the best outcomes. To speak more about how CHS is systematically advancing towards recognition as a high reliability organization, I'll be joined by Leslie Giglio, System Vice President for Risk Management, Patient Safety, and our Chief Privacy Officer at CHS. Please stay tuned to today's episode of CHS Presents Health Connect.
Our bodies tell a story, each incredibly unique, shaped by family history, passed on from one generation to the next. Where you got your eyes, your laugh, the little crinkle in your nose, or maybe your risk for heart disease or stroke. As women, we must unite. Seek your history, know your risk, protect your future.
Once there was a boy who did the same thing again and again. One day, he was told he had autism. He got help and slowly learned how to live with it better.
Early intervention can make a lifetime of difference. Learn the signs at autismspeaks.org.
Welcome back to CHS Presents Health Connect. With 6 hospitals, 3 skilled nursing facilities, a home nursing service, and hospice, CHS handles nearly 240,000 emergency department visits, nearly 83,000 hospital admissions, and more than 475,000 outpatient visits yearly. To best serve patients, CHS is committed to promoting and supporting a culture of safety at all times. Joining us now is Leslie Giglio, System Vice President, Risk Management, Patient Safety, and our Chief Privacy Officer at CHS. Welcome, Leslie.
Hello, Dr. O'Shaughnessy.
Can you share with our viewers at home what a high reliability organization is? And then, you know, how does this apply to healthcare?
Sure. A high reliability organization is an organization that has avoided catastrophes while working in high-risk, complex areas. Some examples of these high reliability organization is a commercial airline as well as a nuclear power plant. Mm-hmm. In contrast, healthcare, there have been several studies in healthcare, such as the Institute of Medicine study to err is human, which has shown that 44 to 80,000 yes. deaths per year have occurred from preventable harm in healthcare organizations.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's tremendous when you look at the correlation. And, you know, there's always debate in the literature around the numbers, but the end result, and this is a very powerful statistic for folks at home, we like to say it's the equivalent. You mentioned commercial aviation, right? Mm-hmm. It's the equivalent of a 747 a day going down. Now, that's not to say that healthcare is not making tremendous strides forward, but we would not tolerate such a safety event profile in commercial aviation. We wouldn't fly. And I think what's so important about this journey that CHS is on mm-hmm. is that we are taking those same principles and applying them to our healthcare space to make our healthcare safer. Can you share a little bit about the principles of high reliability for our viewers at home?
Sure. So some of the traditional principles of high reliability include preoccupation with failure. This is never being satisfied with your level of safety and always trying to be more alert. Reluctance to simplify organizations. This is when you are resistant to simplify why things succeed or fail, and you dig deep to find the real reasons and not just look at the surface. A sensitive to operation. This is also referred to, and I'll be speaking about this later, as situational awareness. This is understanding what's going on around you and recognizing small threats. A deference to expertise is when a high reliability organization mm-hmm. looks to the people closest to the event right. and listens to what they have to say about how to fix things. And they don't pay attention to rank or seniority in the facility. The last one is commitment to resilience. This refers to an organization's ability, despite all their efforts, to recognize that errors will occur and safety will be threatened. Resilience is when an organization recognizes small errors and contains them quickly, thereby preventing harm.
So, Leslie, you did a great job outlining the key pillars of what really encompasses high reliability organizational construct. But, you know, for the viewers at home, and I think they understand industries like commercial aviation and mm-hmm. what's made it safe, I think one of the most exciting things about this body of work is that it's taking those same concepts and applying them to the healthcare space. And leading this charge is actually Dr. Mark Chasson, the president and CEO of the Joint Commission. And I'm very proud to say that CHS will be featured in their video, Leading the Way to Zero. So we've committed to this from our chairman of the board and mm-hmm. our president and CEO, Dr. Gersey, yourself, myself, we're all working hard to this. But tell our viewers, how does this equate to our mission and vision at CHS?
Sure. So CHS mission is a healing mission which promotes excellence in care. And with excellence in care, we would always want to have safe care.
Right.
So we have educated our staff to see healthcare through the eyes of a patient.
Right.
So what are the three things that a patient would want? Don't hurt me, heal me, and be kind to me.
Right. So a great mantra that we embody and we share with our patients, don't harm me, heal me, be kind to me. But I hear all the time from my colleagues, in the clinical trenches, so to speak, Patrick, we appreciate the safety processes that have been engineered into agencies such as commercial aviation.
Mm-hmm.
But in healthcare, is zero preventable harm really achievable? And can you give some examples about how CHS is moving along that journey? And we've demonstrated some success in that arena.
Sure. So we have partnered with healthcare performance improvement consultants to help us on this journey. They have helped over 800 healthcare organizations across the country promote safety and improve their high reliability. We began our journey by teaching our leaders mm-hmm. the error prevention techniques that you were speaking about previously. We've created and rolled out daily patient safety principles for all of our staff. These principles describe some of the safety behaviors that you were speaking about. Some of these behaviors include using a common language while you're trying to speak up for patient safety, as well as some of the cross-checking of our peers. Now, you may have seen this in the airline industry.
Right.
You may have recognized when you get on a plane, mm-hmm. two people are checking the safety or the closing of a door, mm-hmm. and one will say to the other, cross-check, mm-hmm. cross-check me.
Right.
So in healthcare, we haven't always been comfortable mm-hmm. cross-checking our peers,
yeah.
and this is one of the safety behaviors that we will be teaching.
It's a great example, and I think for our viewers at home, the capabilities of most human minds is really in terms of skill-based errors is 1 in 1,000, which that means is that Each person has the ability to make a mistake one out of every 1,000 times. But to the point you just mentioned, if you're cross-checking me and I'm cross-checking you, it's a multiplicative of error reduction. So
right.
1 in 1,000 times 1 in 1,000, you've taken 1 in 1,000 error probability and you reduced it to 1 in 1 million.
Correct.
So that is exceptionally powerful. Are there other examples of things that you're doing? I heard there's another technique called STAR, stop, think, act, review.
Sure. So that's basically just pausing before you do something. Stop, think, act, review. Look at what you're doing, make sure it's correct. This is sort of a double check in your own mind before you move forward. And this as well can catch errors before they happen.
Right. I do that all the time before I leave the house. Wallet, keys, coffee. But, really, when you look at the literature, just even that two-second pause, right? And you think about this in healthcare, we're doing very complex things that are mm-hmm. tightly coupled. They happen very close together, which can set us up for error. But that two-second pause, even of itself, can reduce errors by over 10%, tenfold reduction just with doing that.
Right.
So before we're passing a high-risk med, mm-hmm. before we're hanging blood product,
mm-hmm.
these are the things that we're going to be training our people. You mentioned something called the daily patient safety principles. Now, what I like to think of that as is a people bundle, and it encapsulates a whole list of items that we're training on, some of which we mentioned. But can you talk a little bit about culture of safety and why that's so important?
Sure. So we, part of our training, after we roll out error prevention training, mm-hmm. we will be educating all of our leaders in just culture and high reliability principles. Just culture, as James Reason, who is a pioneer in this field, has indicated, is an atmosphere of trust in which people are not afraid to speak up.
Yes.
And this is very important in a organization to try to get to high reliability, because if we don't know about our errors, then we can't fix them.
That's right.
So it's flattening the hierarchy so that everyone is considered to have the same power when it comes to safety, because safety is the most important thing in our delivery of healthcare.
You know, and I love this example from the naval aviation world. In fact, one of our lead trainers is a retired combat F-18 pilot, and he said, the beauty of carrier operations, which are so complex and high risk, is that mm-hmm. an 18-year-old on a flight deck, all she or he has to do is just do this, and the plane doesn't launch. Everything stops. And I think reducing that vertical power gradient is so important. I think we in healthcare now, and especially at CHS, we're learning to work as interactive teams and to
right.
listen to each other and respect each other. And I think the whole point you mentioned about just culture is that in healthcare, traditionally, we've punished people for their mistakes. And that's something that we're changing now. Again, in the aviation world, and I'm a pilot, I'm only punished if I don't report an event. The FAA will say to me, you reported, you misflew in an area or whatnot, that's okay, it's not an issue. It's if I hide it or I don't report it, that's a problem.
Right.
And I think to your point, that's what Just Culture is trying to do. It's trying to say, let's develop a fair and accountable culture.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not to say that if someone did something egregious that resulted in a harm event, well, then we do need to take action. But the greater majority
Correct.
Of these events are really process-driven, where any human being has the potential to make that error. Is that accurate?
That's accurate.
Yeah.
And it's very important. We need to let everyone speak up. And that's also why we're educating all our staff across the healthcare system, continuing care, acute care, no matter what their role is in
That's
the
right.
organization. We're not just educating the people at the top and the leaders. We're educating everyone, no matter whether they're clinical or non-clinical. They all play an important role in safe care.
That's right. Cross-continuum training. When we get back, we'll continue to discuss how CHS is on its journey to becoming a high-reliability organization. Please stay tuned to CHS Presents Health Connect right here on Telecare.
We women sure know a lot of numbers by heart, but do you know the most critical numbers for your heart health? That knowledge could save your life. Do you know your numbers? Talk to your healthcare provider today to learn your health numbers. Your heart depends on it.
He helped me learn to read.
It is the best feeling in the world. They impact me. I'm proud of the work that I'm doing.
There's been dramatic results in our kindergarten classroom this year from having a foster grandparent.
Welcome back to CHS Presents Health Connect. We're here with Leslie Giglio, System Vice President, Risk Management, Patient Safety, and Chief Privacy Officer at CHS. We were talking a little bit before the break about error prevention techniques and tools. We mentioned a few things like STAR and cross-check and how that reduces errors. But, you know, sometimes in healthcare, as we're giving communication back and forth, communication, when you look at harm event, is causal in so many things. I misunderstand what you say, and I take an action because of it. And this has been, you know, paramount and published well in medication errors, where there are errors in what was communicated and people give people the wrong dose of medications. Can you share a little bit about some of the techniques here for three-way communication and confirming what's being said? What are we training our people on?
Sure. So we're training our people on read back and repeat back.
Yes.
And maybe you can give us an example of that with a medication order that you would be giving to a nurse.
Now, most times these are all entered electronically, but there are occasions where verbal orders may be entered. And this is a great way to ensure effective communication. So thinking back to my emergency room days, maybe the order is, hi, good afternoon, Nurse Giglio. It's Dr. O'Shaughnessy. I'd like you to give Jane Smith, date of birth 11/17/70, Cardizem 25 milligrams rapid IV push. And if you notice, our nurse is writing down the order and ensuring accuracy. She will now read this back, and then I have an opportunity to either affirm and say correct or incorrect.
Okay, so Dr. O'Shaughnessy, let me repeat that back to you. That's Jane Smith, date of birth 11/17/70, Cardizem 25 milligrams rapid IV push. Is that correct?
That is correct.
That's a very powerful tool.
Right.
And that has really shown to avert errors. And we've also seen very serious errors when it is not read back and it is misunderstood,
yeah,
especially when it comes to medication safety.
Now, one other thing that we're embracing around, and for our viewers at home, we've adopted in looking back historically at where we've had harm events, we've put in place three red rules. And what red rules are items for really absolute compliance for safety. We're going to hold the line on these things and hold everybody accountable. Can you share those three red rules?
Sure. So we have three red rules, which are part of our daily patient safety principles. What a red rule is, you have to have absolute compliance each and every time. The red rules that we follow are double check for blood transfusions, two patient identifications, and doing a timeout before invasive procedures.
Right. So name and date of birth for every patient.
Correct.
Universal across the system. The timeout before any invasive procedure. And again, that comes from the other industry. Actually, you know, when you look at checklists and whatnot, the timeout component is so important. Before we start, let's just check and make sure we have everything organized properly. There's no high-risk situation. Everybody's comfortable. The team is aligned. Then we begin. And then the two-person check. And again, we shared earlier in the presentation about the power of the cross-check.
Right.
Taking 1 in 1,000 error to 1 in 1,000,000 error. So on things such as high-risk medications and blood products, we're going to be doing that cross-check. So I think those are just really wonderful, wonderful examples of how our teams now are being trained, which will impact the patients at the bedside. We talked a little bit about just culture before as well. How do you think adopting just culture will impact healthcare in general?
So I think adopting just culture will really enable people to speak up that would never have spoken up before. It's giving the power to people who may not be in the top hierarchy of an organization.
That's right.
There's a great example of this in one of the videos that we saw during our training. This involved an environmental services employee who was happened to be in the room while they were doing an invasive procedure. Just prior to the procedure, she had walked in, and she noticed, I learned about that time out in my training,
right.
And they are not doing time out. And she felt empowered to raise her hand and say, doctor, are you going to do a time out before this invasive procedure? And the doctor stopped and listened because he respected her.
Yes.
And that is really what is so important about having a just culture.
So as part of this program, we've instituted some exciting new operational changes and programs, and also recognized so many of our talented frontline care leaders with awards and recognition.
Mm-hmm.
But let's talk about one of those programmatic changes that all of our campuses do every morning to brief and ensure patient safety. Can you share with our viewers the daily patient safety huddle?
Sure. So this is a very exciting activity. So every day, we have a daily patient safety huddle at all of our entities, continuing care division as well as the acute care hospitals, where all the leaders of the organization get together for 15 minutes. And the agenda includes looking back, looking ahead, and talking about any serious safety issues that we may need to know about in the future.
So and it could be something like, we've got two people with last name Johnson having both the joint surgery and how to make sure we don't have a mix up there. It could be we're short on beds in the ICU and we need to transfer some folks down as appropriate clinically to create capacity. Anything that could impact safety with a look back and a look ahead is discussed. Is that correct?
That's correct.
It's been
very powerful for our leaders. They have really embrace these safety huddles and feel that they're extremely valuable because they get an overview of what's happening at their organization, which they may not have had before.
That's great. Now, how about some of the awards? I know that we've instituted some pretty exciting awards and opportunities for folks to share the great work that they're doing. I know you've taken across the system the Patient Safety Hero Award. We've got Zero Harm Awards. Can you share a little bit about what those programs
are? Sure. So we have several awards where we recognize individuals and teams. We have a Pinnacle Award, mm-hmm. which we do every year. It's an internal Pinnacle Award from the Healthcare Association of New York State, and we recognize those teams or individuals' mm-hmm. internal projects that have improved patient care. We also have a Zero Harm Award, which shows an individual or team's commitment to achieving high reliability and decreasing patient harm. And lastly, our newest award is the Patient Safety Hero Award. And this is recognizing a team or individual who has made a significant contribution to improving patient care.
So like a great example would be if someone stops the line. We say that all the time, right? We are concerned, we are uncomfortable, and we need to stop here and get clarification.
Mm-hmm.
So there may be an instance where an individual, to your example earlier, may not have done the timeout. And we're going to challenge the person to stop the line, and as a result, prevent perhaps a harm event from occurring. Now we have an opportunity to celebrate those individuals, and we share that in the award ceremony. So I think these are all just great examples of ways that we really encourage just culture, and we are really rapidly advancing patient safety. Thank you for speaking with us today, Leslie. We'll be right back for my final thoughts and my health tips and solution of the day. Stay tuned. And now my final thoughts on our discussion today. High reliability healthcare is achievable. At CHS, we've made this commitment from the very top down. It flows from our chairman of the board and our president and chief executive officer down to every frontline staff member caring for all of our patients. Now, that's not to say that care rendered in any CHS facility is unsafe. In fact, it is quite safe. However, we are committing to making this journey, to making our care the safest possible for our patients. And now, some top tips to keep your kids healthy. My focus in this segment is to provide our viewers with a source of truth. You know, we're continually being marketed to, and some different sites of information are marketing different products. And it's hard to really get a grasp on what's true, what's not, and what you should follow. So for today's segment, I would like to make you aware of www.aap.org. I'm going to share with you more about what the American Academy of Pediatrics recommends to help keep your little ones safe and healthy. And I'm sure everyone is aware of some of the more common things we can do to keep our kids healthy. I know I have my little one always carry some hand sanitizer around, make sure we're disinfecting those hands and covering our mouth and nose when we sneeze. But other habits such as encouraging healthy eating and regular physical activity are so important. Childhood obesity is such a major public health dilemma now, and we have to do more to keep our kids active. In addition, though, to healthy eating and the benefits of regular physical activity, a good night's sleep enables children to be alert, attentive, and in a better state for learning and retaining information in school. If getting a good night's sleep proves difficult, it may help to set a sleep schedule for going to bed, and actually even keeping a sleep diary to keep record of when your child is going to bed and waking up each day. As I mentioned before, make sure your child sees a pediatrician regularly, and the American Academy of Pediatrics, and here's that website again, www.aap.org, also recommends childhood screening as an essential component of health supervision and provides a foundation for monitoring and supporting healthy physical, cognitive, and psychosocial development. Please check their Screening in Practices initiative for more information and resources. Not only will these tips help keep your child healthy now, but they will hopefully develop into habits that will bring lifelong benefits. Also remember that children imitate adults. So as we as parents also try to incorporate these health tips into our own lives, our children will most likely follow. And that's my tip for today. If you would like to know more about how CHS is advancing towards recognition as a high reliability organization, or to make a gift in support of this or another program that is important to you, please visit chsli.org. From there, you can click through to the websites of each of our healthcare partners for more information on ways to give. We are always grateful for the community's support because your gift today helps shape the healthcare of tomorrow. Thank you for watching today. If you have any medically related questions you'd like me to answer on future shows, please email us at healthconnect@chsli.org. Please include your name and a way to contact you in case we need to reach you. I'm Dr. Patrick O'Shaughnessy, and I hope to see you next time on CHS Presents Health Connect.